Heavenly Father, we love you. And we come this morning hungry to meet with you, hungry to hear from you. We have so many voices in our lives and in our world that try and speak into us day after day after day. We need to hear your voice. And so this morning, as we come to your word, we're grateful for it. We're grateful for the opportunity to look into your word together. And we ask that by your Spirit, you would speak loudly and clearly to each heart here. Whether we need to be built up and encouraged this morning or challenged and confronted this morning, whatever it might be, would you meet us right here and impact our hearts, our minds, our thinking, and our lives with your word for your glory. And we surrender this time for that purpose in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, this morning we continue a series we started last week in the life of David. And we come to a dangerous passage this morning. In fact, as I was going through the eight different events in the life of David that we were going to address in this series, I almost skipped this one. And I almost skipped it because it's a dangerous passage. And here's what makes it dangerous. The passage we're going to look at this morning is very familiar to most of us. It's almost too familiar to some of us. Some of us, when we hear the words this morning, David and Goliath, we are going to go, oh, yep, got it. And we're going to check out. And we're going to start thinking about tomorrow and planning the week ahead. It's a dangerous passage because we'll assume that maybe we've heard it. We get it. There's nothing more to learn here. It's familiar to us in church circles. It's also familiar to us in our culture. It has become so familiar that when you hear the phrase David and Goliath outside of these walls, you don't know what people are referring to. They could be referring to the actual event and confrontation between David and Goliath. They might. Some people might use those words and not have any clue who David and Goliath really are. They might be talking about a game or sporting event where the underdog came through in the end. They could be talking about a political race. They could be talking about a courtroom battle or a fight in a schoolyard. They could be talking about a tiny one-man company facing a mighty corporation. They could be talking about anything when they say David and Goliath. And so that phrase, David and Goliath, has almost been relegated to a quaint little phrase. Just a little saying we have. We've turned it into kind of a, you know, it's a VeggieTales cartoon kind of a thing. Almost making it as though it was a mythical story. The problem is it's none of those things. And so even though I feel like I'm on the Discovery Channel this morning, I feel like I am prompted and need to say to you as we begin, the story that you are about to hear is real. It's real. It's not made up. It's not fabricated on any level. The events you will hear about this morning are real. The people are real. The places are real. The events are real. The danger is tangible. The stakes are high. And we have before us this morning in 1 Samuel 17, the recording of an event that involves three men, two nations, and one God. Three men, two nations, and one God. I invite you to turn to 1 Samuel chapter 17 with me this morning. There are a lot of different approaches we could take to this particular passage. So I decided this morning, here's what we're going to do. We will simply look at what happened. Then we'll ask, why did it happen? And then we'll try and figure out if we show up anywhere in here and there's anything we can take out of this. All right, so that will be our approach. So the first thing is, what happened? Look at verse 1. Now the Philistines gathered their forces of war for war and assembled at Socoh in Judah. They pitched camp at Ephes-Damim between Socoh and Azekah. Saul and the Israelites assembled and camped in the valley of Elah and drew up their battle line to meet the Philistines. The Philistines occupied one hill and the Israelites another with the valley between them. Two nations, two armies, each on a hillside, looking across at the other with a valley between them. A champion named Goliath, who was from Gath, came out of the Philistine camp. He was over 9 feet tall. He had a bronze helmet on his head and wore a coat of scale armor of bronze weighing 5,000 shekels. I'm told that's about 125 pounds. On his legs, he wore bronze greaves, and a bronze javelin was slung on his back. His spear shaft was like a weaver's rod, and its iron point weighed 600 shekels. That's about 15 pounds. His shield bearer went ahead of him. Probably more for formality and appearance than necessity. Goliath stood and shouted to the ranks of Israel, "Why do you come out and line up for battle? Am I not a Philistine? Are you not the servants of Saul? Choose a man and have him come down to me. If he's able to fight and kill me, we will become your subjects. But if I overcome him and kill him, you will become our subjects and serve us." Then the Philistine said, "This day I defy the ranks of Israel. Give me a man and let us fight each other." On hearing the Philistine's words, Saul and all the Israelites were dismayed and terrified. Let's look at three men this morning. The first is King Saul. Saul came out with his army and he lined up on the side of the hill looking across the valley at the Philistine army and camped over there. He knew the battle had come. The time to fight had arrived. And what we find is, instead of these two armies going head-to-head, as would happen occasionally in those cultures at that time, they would have representative warfare. Here's what we're going to do. It's kind of like when you can't settle a hockey game in 60 minutes and you just say, okay, we're going to have a shootout. Right? We're going to put it all on one guy and see what happens. And that's what happened. They said, "We'll put our best guy out, you bring your toughest guy out, and let him go at it." Now the problem is, I haven't read anywhere in recorded history an actual event where they did this and the losers actually said, "Yeah, okay, you won." We're going to see that later on this morning. They did this one-on-one thing, and when the one army was defeated, they didn't just cave in and say, "Yeah, okay, we'll be your slaves." That's not human nature, isn't it? We talk a good game up front. But anyway, Goliath comes down and he's issuing this challenge. And Saul, who in his time had been quite the warrior, Saul, who was bigger, head and shoulders above the rest of the men of Israel, Saul, who was king, met a physical challenge that was way out of his league. It was far and above anything he could handle. He looked at Goliath and he said, "I can't do this." And Saul, along with the armies of Israel, shook in fear. And we're told in this passage that for 40 days, every day, Goliath had put on the boots and put on the armor and put on a helmet and call over his shield bearer and pick up his javelin and sling it on his back and pick up his sword, and away he'd go, and he'd come out and he'd shout the same challenge over and over again for 40 days. And every day, you know what happened? Saul, their king and champion of Israel, shook in fear and ran to hide, and all his soldiers with him. Saul was paralyzed by fear. And the interesting thing is that back in 1 Samuel chapter 8, verse 20, we have the conversation between Samuel and the people of Israel when they were demanding a king. And Samuel says, "Do you realize where this will take you? Do you realize the tax burden a king is going to put on you? Do you realize what he's going to do? He's going to take your children to be his servants. Do you understand all that this is going to involve?" And here's what the people said. They refused to listen to Samuel. "No," they said, "we want a king over us. Then we will be like all the other nations." The whole point was they weren't supposed to be like all the nations. They were supposed to be different, of course. "We'll be like all the other nations with a king to lead us. A king to go out before us, this way, boys, and fight our battles. We want a king that'll go up front, lead us, cheer us on, lead us into battle, and fight our battles for us." That was the point. That's what they wanted. That's what they had in Saul for a while. On this particular occasion, Saul got up and he stood outside and he wanted to hear who was yelling over and issuing such a challenge. And he looked, and what he saw frightened him down to the core of his being. And now, Israel's champion, the one who was to go out and fight our battles for us, was hiding in his tent. Can you imagine such a thing? What do you think the Israelites did? They did the very same thing. Their champion was nervous and afraid, so they hid. In fact, in verse 13, we're told Jesse's three oldest sons had followed Saul to the war. These are David's older brothers. Eliab was the firstborn, the second Abinadab, and the third Shema. David was the youngest. The three oldest followed Saul. What did they do? Like the other young men of Israel, Saul's the king. He's heading out to war. Let's go, boys. We will defend our country. We will serve our king. Let's go. And they went out there, and when they saw their champion, the king, shaking, what did these three do? Say, it's okay, sir, we've got it? No. If Saul can't handle this guy, if Saul is afraid, we all better be afraid. And they all hid and shook in fear. Incredible. They're paralyzed by this fear. Now, can I just point out to you this morning a couple of different things here. One is this. Lots of people want to lead when that means there's days of privilege and parades to ride in. Fewer people want to lead when there's a difficult, demanding, dangerous job to do. Isn't that interesting? It's great to be king while people are bringing you grapes. A little harder to be king when a 9-foot giant down there clad in armor is calling you out. Here's something else to take note of. As we saw last week, Saul had decided to take being king of Israel, and instead of making it about God and the people of God, he decided to make it all about himself. Even when confronted over sin, he didn't repent and say, oh, forgive me. He said, hey, you can still make me look good to these people, right? Saul had made the kingship of Israel all about himself. And what did we read at the end of 1 Samuel 15? God took his spirit from him. When you make something all about you, you stand alone. When you stand alone, you're toast. It's not complicated. Saul said, I'm going to do this king thing, and it's about me. Watch me go. Until the day he stood across from Goliath and realized he's standing alone. God had left him. You want to do this? Knock yourself out. And he's standing facing Goliath all by himself. Well, that's one guy. That's King Saul. Take a look at Goliath for a moment. We have record in different places through Joshua and Samuel about the people from Gath and the size of these guys. And here is Goliath. He thought that he was too great for any and every challenger to handle. Whatever he was going to face that day, he was sure he would overcome. He had no fear whatsoever when he put on his battle gear. He had no fear whatsoever when he walked with his shield bearer out into the valley by himself. He had no fear at all as he screamed at the top of his lungs, why don't one of you turkeys come down here and fight me so I can crush you? No fear at all. Complete arrogance, complete confidence in himself. Goliath made this all about himself. Now, he talked about the Philistines and the servants of Saul. Interesting phrase. He didn't call them Israelites. You're Saul's servants, right? Well, how would you like to come and fight me and then you can be our servants instead? Goliath was all about Goliath. And when you make something about yourself, you stand alone. And when you stand alone, you're toast. And I don't care how big you are. That's just the way it works. And so he mocks He mocks the Israelites. He mocks them and says, you've got to be kidding me. There isn't one over there who can come down here and fight me. There isn't one who even has the courage, the guts to say, I'm going to stand up and at least try to defend my people and their honor. For 40 days, we're going to go through this game. Finally, when David goes out to see him, here was what Goliath said in verse 43 of 1 Samuel 17. He said to David, am I a dog that you come at me with sticks? Am I just this little neighborhood dog that's an annoyance and you're just throwing this little thing at it to kind of swat it away? Are you kidding me? Why won't you guys take me seriously? Look at me. I'm Goliath. Tell you what's going to happen at the end of the day. I am going to tear you to shreds and feed you to the birds. How do you like that? Goliath is not happy that he's being treated this disrespectfully because he'd made it all about himself, of course. Am I a dog that you come at me with sticks? And the Philistine cursed David by his gods. Come here, he said, and I'll give your flesh to the birds of the air and the beasts of the field. Goliath, in anger, mocks David as well as the people of Israel. We have King Saul, who decided to make being king of Israel all about himself, and one day found he was standing alone because he'd made it about himself, so he was by himself. And he was facing something that was way out of his league he could not handle. You have Goliath, who was a mighty champion of the Philistines. If you were picking teams, he'd go first every time. We want Goliath, because then we win, right? No point in finishing the draft here. And Goliath made everything about Goliath. He cursed the people of Israel. He cursed David in the name of his gods and said, you got to be kidding me. This is the best you have? Of all that army, you're going to send me this little guy? Come on. Come on. Well, there's a third man in this story, and that, of course, is David. David comes to the scene. He's sent by his father to go, and he travels. This is about maybe 17 miles southwest of Jerusalem where this encounter is taking place. And so he's sent out from the hills of Bethlehem. His father sends him with a bunch of supplies for his brothers. Go and take this food to them. Go and take this nice gift basket to their commanding officer so they'll be treated nice, right? We want to stay in good with that guy. And then bring something back from them that proves to me they're still alive, they're still well, they're still doing okay. Go and find out. You know, there's no Anderson Cooper standing right there on the battle lines, right? I don't know what's going on out there. So they ship him out. So that's David's deal. Okay, he leaves the sheep with another shepherd and off he goes. So he goes, he takes the food, he brings all the supplies, he leaves them in the tent with all the supplies. He says, hey, what's going on, guys? What do you mean, what's going on? We're all hiding over here behind the trees. Take a look. David assesses the situation. He sees the Philistine army on the other side. He sees and hears Goliath standing in the valley. He sees what's going on in the camp of Israel. And David is able to make this assessment. He looks, he listens, and he says, what we have here is a spiritual battle in physical form. And so you guys are just looking at the surface. You just think this is a physical confrontation. That's not it at all. This is a spiritual issue with a spiritual solution, and you guys are hiding from this? This is incredible. Just as God had said to Samuel, as we saw last week, Samuel, you're looking at the surface. You're impressed by these guys, by their size and their height, their appearance, and their resume. These guys are just fantastic. You're so impressed. You're looking on the surface. I'm looking at the heart. And I'm not just passing over these guys. I've rejected them. I have chosen one with a heart, a man after my own heart. He's the guy we're going with. And here he is, standing there, with all the mighty warriors of Israel and their warrior king, their champion Saul, hiding in their tents. And David says, are you kidding me? This is crazy. This isn't the way it's supposed to go. When you read verse 25 and 26 of 1 Samuel 17, you find this. Now the Israelites had been saying, do you see how this man keeps coming out? He comes out to defy Israel. The king will give great wealth to the man who kills him. He will also give him his daughter's hand in marriage and will exempt his father's family from taxes in Israel. Saul's not willing to do his job. But he's willing to pay well for someone else to step up and do it. That's what we're supposed to read in there. Okay, verse 26. David asked the men standing near him, "What will be done for the man who kills this Philistine and removes this disgrace from Israel? Who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? What are you guys talking about?" The people of Israel refer to Goliath as a man. David refers to him as an uncircumcised Philistine. He's not just a man. He's an enemy of God, and he's an enemy of God's people. Like, call it what it is, boys. We're not talking about arm wrestling here. He's an enemy of God, and he's an enemy of God's people. Who is this uncircumcised Philistine? He's going to talk to God's people that way? He's going to talk about God that way? And we're just going to stand here? Wow. The men of Israel said, he comes out to defy Israel. David said, guys, take your eyes off yourselves. He comes out to defy the armies of the living God. And if you defy the armies of the living God, who are you slapping in the face? God himself. This is the best you got? I'll squash them all. He's defying God. And you're going to stand there? Guys, listen and look at what's going on. The men of Israel say, here's what Saul will do for the person who does what? The person who kills this man. David says, what's going to be done for the person who kills this uncircumcised Philistine and removes this disgrace from Israel? David's telling these guys, you guys are a complete disgrace. You know, you might have signed up to be all you can be, but it ain't much. I mean, this is Israel's army? You're hearing this for 40 days and you're letting that go on? Somebody's got to remove this disgrace from the name of God and the name of God's people. Someone's got to step up and deal with this. Incredible. And so David acted in faith. Instead of hiding in fear as King Saul and the rest of the men, David acted in faith. We're told in verse 24 here, when the Israelites saw the man, Goliath, they all ran from him in great fear. We're told in verse 48 this, as the Philistine moved closer to attack him, David ran quickly toward the battle line to meet him. Probably the first time in Goliath's life anybody ran at him. What's this? This is new? Usually people see me coming and they run. That's what the rest did, and this little guy's running at me? What, did he not get the memo? Like, check me out. That's what Goliath's thinking. But David, instead of hiding paralyzed by fear, he acts in faith. He relies on God. And he references, in fact, when he's talking to Saul, he goes, you're worried about Goliath? Man, when I'm looking after my dad's sheep, a bear came and a bear took one of the lambs and left. I didn't just write it off as the cost of doing business. Oh, well, you look after sheep in the hills, you're going to lose a few. He says, you know what I did? I went and I grabbed the bear and said, what are you doing? I killed the bear and took the lamb back. Another time a lion came and took away one of Dad's lambs. Hey, that's not yours. He walks over and he kills the lion and he comes back with the lamb. David said, who did that? God did that. I'm just me. But you got to do what you got to do. And when you're given a responsibility, you stand up and you do it. Now, he's saying these things, and the conversation between he and Paul sounds like he's trying to be somewhat, he's trying to be somewhat respectful still to Saul. But you can read between the lines, and it's got to be getting a little hot under the collar for Saul. This kid is going to reference all these things. What about you, Saul? What about all the battles you've been in? You've actually fought guys like this. You're not going to do it? Tell you what, God helped me kill a lion. God helped me kill a bear, and that was over a sheep. These are God's people, and God's name's on the line. Where do I sign up? God, who killed the lion and the bear through me. God, who delivered me from them. Creatures bigger and stronger and fiercer than I am. He can handle this guy. And what does David do? David walks out in faith and he kills Goliath. He takes his shepherd's sling, He picks up some stones. He puts one in a little pouch. And as he's running towards Goliath, he's running and he's swinging that sling. And eventually he lets one end go. It hits him in the forehead and Goliath comes crashing down face first. So what does he do? David runs over, we're told. He takes the sword from Goliath. I mean, it must have been the size of David himself, eh? He takes the sword out, finishes him off, and then off with his head. Holds up the head. Looks up at the hill of the Philistine army. Who's next? And Israel pursues and chases the Philistine army. And David proceeds to Jerusalem, which is still held by the Jebusites at that point and is not under Israeli control. And he takes it to Jerusalem and goes, "You're next. Your day's coming. I'll leave this for you boys." David acted in faith, trusting that God would take care of this threat to God's name and God's people. And David came out there and David dealt with the issue. And the difference is this. Saul made this whole confrontation about Saul and found out when you do that, you're standing alone and you can't handle it. Goliath had made this all about him and thought he was the best thing the world had ever seen. And he found out different, didn't he? David was the one of the three who understood that this was actually about God. And he said, "This isn't about you. This isn't about me. This isn't about him. This is about God. So let's just do what we've been called to do and let God handle the details." Wow. Wow. Why did it happen? It happened because we had a king who would not stand up. It happened because David needed to stand for God's name and God's people. As we saw in verse 26, who is this uncircumcised Philistine that he should defy the armies of the living God? He's offending God. He's offending God's people. We're not going to put up with this. He's going to stand up for God's name and God's people. David trusted God to deliver him. As we've already referenced here, verse 37, "The Lord who delivered me from the paw of the lion and the paw of the bear will deliver me from the hand of this Philistine." God will do it. Verse 45, "David said to the Philistine, 'You come against me with sword and spear and javelin, but I come against you in the name of the Lord Almighty, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have defied. This day the Lord will hand you over to me, and I'll strike you down and cut off your head. Today I'll give the carcasses, not just of you, but of the whole Philistine army, to the birds of the air and the beasts of the earth.'" Whoa. And David said, "Who's going to do that? God is. The God you're defying. He's going to do this. And you think you've disgraced us by calling us out like this for 40 days? What are they going to be saying about the mighty Goliath who was taken out by a shepherd boy in hand-to-hand combat?" Wow. David trusted God to deliver. You know what happened? God did. And verse 46 ends this way. "And the whole world will know that there is a God in Israel." Implication? I don't know who you guys are serving, but he's got nothing. Everyone will know, wherever the report gets out, that there is a God in Israel, and he is to be taken seriously. All those gathered here will know that it is not by sword or spear that the Lord saves, for the battle is the Lord's, and he will give all of you into our hands. He gives Goliath. Goliath's not going to be around to see all this. So he's giving Goliath kind of an advance report on what's going to happen. "Goliath, God's going to hand you over to me, and I will cut off your head. It's over. Like, look around and enjoy the view, because this is it. You're done. And when you're done, everyone in the world isn't going to be talking about the mighty Goliath. Everyone in the world is going to say, 'Wow, there is a God in Israel. How are we going to handle this?' And all these guys up here that you've got shaking in their little boots and hiding in their tents, they're going to finally understand that it's not about a sword or a spear or a shield or how big and tough and bold you think you are. The battle is God's. And when you're serving God, you serve God. And you stand for God and you stand in God's name and you let God handle it because the battle's His. That's what took place. So God did this for the glory and honor of His name. And we read verse 51 of 1 Samuel 17. David ran and stood over him. He took hold of the Philistine's sword and drew it from the scabbard. After he killed him, he cut off his head with the sword. Wow. And we say, look at this story. Who is the hero? Goliath? Apparently not. Who's the hero? King Saul? Israel champion? No, he's hiding up there. I know who the hero is. David, the anointed kid from out in the hills there with the sheep, who came in with the sling. David's the hero. No. No. God is the hero. This was God's name, God's people, God's battle, God's victory. He just brought it through His man, who had a heart after God and would trust Him to do it. Amen? That's it. That's it. So what about me? I am not suggesting that you go out and buy a holster this afternoon, a nice slingshot, and start collecting rocks. I would, on the other hand, suggest that you look rather closely at your life, at your circumstances, and at your situations. And ask yourself, do you see spiritual battles and realities in what you encounter? Or are you too just looking on the surface and you just see the physical? Do you deal in the realm of the way things appear? Or like David, will you look a little deeper to the way things are? How do you see what's going on in and around your life? Will you stand for God's name and God's people? Maybe somebody's blaspheming God's name, mocking the name of Christ. You're going to shrink away like Saul? You're going to stand up and say, do you know who you're talking about? This is the God of the universe, His Son Jesus, your only hope for forgiveness. The Lord of all. Somebody's gossiping and talking about one of your brothers or sisters in Christ and they're maligning God's people and they're causing division amongst God's people. You're going to take that? Or are you going to say, hold it. God's name is at stake in how we talk to and about each other. God's name is at stake in how we walk as His people together. What are you doing? You have no right to talk like that. Why don't we get on our knees and pray for this person? And while we're at it, maybe a few people could ask for some forgiveness too. Will you stand for God's name and God's people? Will you stand not just for God's name and God's people, but as God's people, will you stand in His name? In His name? Proverbs 18 says this. We're going to sing this in just a few moments. Proverbs 18 says, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it and are safe. The wealth of the rich is their fortified city. They imagine it an unscalable wall. Oh, I don't have a military hero that I'm trusting in. I'm trusting in my bank account and my investments and everything else. That's my fortified city. That's my insurance policy. That's where I camp out. That's where my security comes from. You might as well be standing like Goliath, clad in armor, just waiting for things to happen. The name of the Lord is a strong tower. The righteous run into it in our safe. Safe. John Ortberg, American pastor, was telling the story of how a few years ago, he and a couple other men from the staff on the church he was at were at a conference in Newport Beach in California. And one night they were out for a walk, and they were walking down the street, and they ended up walking past this bar where there had been a fight going on inside, and like it was some kind of old Western movie or something, these guys came tumbling out, and the fight was now on the street in front of them, and there was a group of men standing around, and they were beating on one guy, and he was bleeding from the head, and they kind of looked at each other and said, "We got to do something here." So he said, "We walked over to break up the fight." He said, three little pastors didn't look all that intimidating, I guess, and he said, "By the way, all we said was, hey, you guys, cut that out." It was kind of an intimidating situation, and it didn't do any good. But he said, all of a sudden, they looked at us again, and they started shaking, and they stood up, and they started backing away, and they kind of all started slinking away. He said, we're going, hey, I wonder what happened. And they turned around, and he said, we turned around, and standing in the doorway behind us, in the doorway to the bar, was the biggest human being I'd ever seen in my life. He said he was over 6 feet, maybe 6'7" or something. He had to be 300 pounds and probably 2% body fat. He was huge. He said, we called him Bubba. Not to his face, mind you, but afterwards, when we talked about the story, we called him Bubba. He said, Bubba didn't say a word. He just stood there and flexed, looking like he was hoping they'd decide to take a run at him. And they ran. But he said, you know what happened? He said, all of a sudden, my attitude changed. My attitude was kind of transformed. And so while those guys were leaving, I suddenly yelled out, you better not let us catch you guys coming around here again. Why? Because I had Bubba. Because Bubba was behind me. And that changed everything. It changed everything. Until you go home, tell the story a few times, get a few laughs at parties, and think about it a little bit, and realize one day that I was just trusting in man like everybody around me does. And I was a child of God, and somebody needed help, and I chose to trust in a man instead of in God. Wow. We need to stand in God's name as God's people. And by the way, we need to stand in God's armor. And that's Ephesians 6, isn't it? That's Ephesians 6. There's an interesting thing that takes place in 1 Samuel 17, verses 38 and 39. When Saul gives in and says, okay, we're going to send this guy to go handle Goliath. We'll see what happens. He decides to put his armor on David. And you know, the movies, the cartoons and whatever in the storybooks, they make it look like David's 6. And Saul's this mighty warrior, and you can't even see out of the thing, right? And he's like this. The reason we're told he didn't wear Saul's armor was that it was uncomfortable. And he's a farm kid. He's a shepherd boy. He's used to running when he's having a conflict here with something. And he wasn't used to this. He wasn't used to this equipment and everything. It was slowing him down, so he got rid of it. But you know what else? What else had Saul given him? Saul had given him his shield, his sword, his breastplate, his helmet, that kind of thing, his equipment. But if you read those verses, Saul had also given him his tunic. What does that mean? Well, I'm told it means this. David, I want you to go as my representative. And when you defeat Goliath, should you? You will defeat him in my name. And I still get some of the credit, even though I'm under the table in the back corner. David did not go in Saul's name. Not only did David leave the equipment behind, David left the tunic and said, you can keep this too. I will go at Goliath in the name of the Lord God Almighty. And when the victory comes, it will be his, and it will be his alone. Wow. You know, as we come to this whole issue of these spiritual battles, these very real things that take place, we read this, finally be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you can take your stand against the devil's schemes. For our struggle is not against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the powers of this dark world, and against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly realms. Therefore, put on the full armor of God so that when the day of evil comes, you may be able to stand your ground, and after you've done everything, to stand. To stand. In his book, Fuzzy Memories, Jack Handy writes this. There used to be this bully who would demand my lunch money every day when I was a kid. And since I was so much smaller, I'd just give it to him. Then one day I decided to fight back, so I started to take karate lessons. And then one day after that, the karate lesson guy said I had to start paying him for lessons. So I just went back to paying the bully because it was cheaper. How many of us take a look at the price tag on standing for God and for God's people? How many of us look at the price tag for standing in God's name as His people and say, you know what? I don't think so. It's cheaper to pay the bully. Wow. Whose name do you stand for? Whose name do you stand in? When you see all the different things you run up against this week in your life, are you like Saul and Abinadab and Eliab and Shammah and all the other Israelites who shook in fear because they simply looked at a physical situation? You're going to have eyes like David, who are focused on the Lord God Almighty,